The other area of an economy that I think we should look at as well, like I said, manufacturing, we'll try to compete in whatever way we can do in manufacturing. We might not compete in everything. We'll not be able to, but let's do what we can. Working around it, making sure that the state also take employees of your employees and train them, because we need to go for higher skill labor now to be able to produce better and more competitive things, of course, equipment and capital or whatnot. So there must be state interventions. Deliberately make sure we succeed. Now, the other area too we should look at is the free zones. The free zones is a very powerful, powerful tool of development, because a lot of companies find it convenient to be in there, lesser issues about taxes, but they employ your people. 30% of the product produced will be sold on the local market here. They would pay pay electricity, water, a lot of service, trucks, etc. And when they going to do export, obviously, there's also a process where we make money from them. So the tax element is not important. As a country, we have gone to a point where we must tailor make some things to suit us. That if it means we'll give this man a tax freeze, it doesn't matter whether it's NDC, MPP, etc. Let's give it to the person, because we are getting jobs from him, we are getting tax revenue from him, and other things that I mentioned earlier on. So, the free zones. Let us attract a lot of people from all over the world. There are lots of people now moving from the Western countries to China because cost of production is cheaper. Of course, China has got a huge market as well. But Africa and West Africa has also got a very huge market. So, why can't we work on a situation where we attract those people to come here? We have got preferential tariff agreements with America, AGWA, all those things. So why don't we get them to come here? But it takes more than just going to talk to them to come here. It takes a government that is trustworthy. They are our face in the world. Whatever they say, do, how they act, how they conduct themselves, how people see them manage an economy properly with futuristic dividends, a certain stability. Okay, predictability of policy, consistency of policy. That person can decide that, okay, instead of investing in Jamaica, I'll come to Ghana. Mind you, investment is a market, and we must compete for it. The man has not come here because we are Ghana. We smile. We are hospitable. So what? It may be part of the ingredients, but his main aim is to make money. And the other countries he can go to make the money. So we must not fool ourselves, oh, yeah, in Ghana, we are everything. Burkina Faso, we are buying tomatoes from them. They are harvesting rain. What are we doing as a people? We started off with massive scientific and technological development. Nuclear, we had it since when? What has become of us? Now let's move on from the free zones area. Let's look at also, obviously the Ghanaian public also have got to be very honest. Stop stealing from foreigners. Because these days, one tweet and we are done as a country. Let's move to the area of services. I think there's an area of service, there are several services that we must enhance. Now, let me be very specific. I'm not a politician out there. I'm giving you specifics. I wish I was a politician, but I'm not. So, let us look at the educational sector. We have all these people coming now from Guinea-Conakry, from Senegal, from Mali, from Ivory Coast, from DRC Congo, from Central African Republic, Nigeria, Togo, all studying in Ghana. Simply because their parents realized a certain stability in this country, a democratic atmosphere, a certain atmosphere of freedom, not a police state. That is what you call planned democracy. We must plan our democracy to give us dividends. Democracy is not practiced in a vacuum. We must get something out of it. All these accolades that we pride ourselves with, we must get something, economic benefits. Nkrumah said that, listen, that if we do not pursue and achieve economic liberation, ambitious economic liberation, one that is comparable to anything in the world, then our fight for independence has been in vain. And that's a fact. So that area, we're already doing it. So what we do is that to declare Cape Coast or Central Region as an educational enclave, then we go around the world, we legislate it properly, back it by law, make sure that we look at what's happening around the world, and anything attractive, we add to it. Then we just go and invite campuses, universities that have got out in abroad, America, Europe, New Zealand, Australia, whatever, South Africa, to come and set up extended campus like a lot of universities. So we have that in place. Okay? Once we do that, they will come, they will put up their own infrastructure, everything. We may just have to do roads and stuff. But you can imagine the Arabs, the Indians, the Sri Lankans, the Pakistanis, because of the bad situation of terrorism now, which has caught up with all of us, they are not allowed to get visas there. But they've got the money to spend. So they should bring their campuses here. We will just make sure our security is in order and then bring them here to come and study. We are collecting money. The foreign currency is coming into our pocket. We have picked somebody's pocket. They willingly give it to us. When you do that, declare that, what happens? It opens up that place. Fast food chains, 24-hour service, transport, electricity, more use of electricity. And you can imagine, tourism will even boost it. Kakum Park, we can even develop it better, create amusement parks. That's how development comes. You see the Malam Kaswa Highway. So after it was created and it was well done, you see how the area has opened up? Residential, commercial. That is development. That is what leadership should be thinking of. Not the kind of discussion that they do on their waves. Debased, cheap, unintelligent, unintellectual thinking. When you have a large majority population of young people in a country who should be fostered but with and nurtured with an intellectual atmosphere, an intellectual society that will be better than us and compete in the world. Otherwise, they come to be a threat to us, kill all of us with all the frustration of unemployment, etc. So that is what we should be doing. Now, outside that, a West African Medical Services Center. Why? All these nurses that have no jobs. Why don't we now license proper schools with the highest standards, even invite some from abroad as well to come, train nurses like Cuba does and export them? We can export human labor. We can export young people also to go and work on farms abroad, learn. We structure in such a way the state will take some time, we'll send them away, we'll negotiate that their settlement is right and everything. We sat in this country. I touted this idea 10 years ago. Today, South Korea has done that. And people are flying past Ghana and going there for the treatment. We're losing all that foreign currency. Just next door. And these countries, they believe in Ghana because of Nkrumah. There's certain, I've lived in those countries. I've been around them. They believe in Nkrumah so much. Look, there are books on Nkrumah that are installed in those countries that we don't have in Ghana. In fact, when I was speaking in Dakar and Guinea-Conakry, a lot of public speaking I did, and the newspaper interviews and things, the people kept asking, are you sure you're not another Nkrumah who has come up again? Are you sure you're not another Nkrumah? I said, no, I'm not. I'm a better form of him in today's 21st century Africa. Now, another area as well that we can also look at is, and I want to stress on that very much because it's also a very key and a very good area that we can make a lot of money in. Exporting ideas. Look, mobile phone content. There are some of these young guys are so dangerous when it comes to that. When I say dangerous, positively dangerous. They are deviants. Constructive deviants. That's why their energy is not being harnessed. No opportunity. So they are not also taught to create them. They are not backed or supported. So these guys are doing sakawa. Now, let me ask you a simple question. What prevents us from creating some big ICT bases in various communities and then get our young people to sit on there, the way they convince people to dupe them, they convince people to come invest in Ghana. We structure a deal in such a way that if you bring the person, you get a certain percentage, or you get a certain payment. Are we thinking as a country? Are we being creative? I mean, are we just thinking of the Abin Waha, which is a very big mess anyway, and we sit in this nation every day, hear the airwaves litigating the past, the failed past, we're litigating it, rather than put our energies into a progressive future. These are the things that as a country we should consider when an election is coming. That we must look at our future, especially the young people of this country who have of voter age. They must think that, hey, let's look at our future, our 100-year future, which Nkrumah thought of and built the Accra and motorway, the ports, Akosombo Dam that you are using today. They are not looking at the Abin Waha, the here and now, but they're looking at the future where capability is required to be able to predict the future and take decisions that respond to the future. To be very strategic in nature and be able to achieve something. And also to work timely, in a timely manner, and to be able to meet the times of urgency. So when an election is coming, Ghana at 59, in this very big mess we find ourselves in, it's a big mess. And it's been a total leadership failure for a long time in this nation. We must capture the moment that is a new moment of promise, because we have the people that we require. The young people of this country, educated middle class and exposed middle class, that together form a new success formation for our country, that will be able, with our creative minds, creative thinking, you know, abilities, extra, obviously having to repair aspects of our education that will make us even more creative and suited for today's world. that will be able to move this agenda, that will just be backed by the old to move this agenda. Now, it is not just being young, as Chemamao said. It is about being young, futuristic thinking with a big mind, mature mind, intellectual thinking. A young person who is thinking about the next person by you. Because that's really what education is. It's not, education is not about what you get for you to use for yourself. Education is about being, it's about acquiring the knowledge, okay, and also skills, etc. Okay, to be able to make sound judgments and also to be able to make it your prime objective to change the next person around you's life to make it better. So we're all transformers. We're all changers. We're all leaders. Young people must be looking, for instance, at education. Because we must have an education that trains us how to think and think intelligently and think globally. The kind of education we have brings chance out people who cannot even think. We must be creative and innovative because we must create an innovative society. Yes, the young people around are good in some technologies and the rest, but we must structure it properly. Now you can use anywhere in the world. And there are some of these things that in Ghana, they were far advanced than some of the advanced countries even. So we have a young population, bright, sound, everything. The education must be tailored to suit that. Science and technology must feature prominently. But you see, it is not 3 or 4 years. Education starts from home. There are certain even nutrients that parents need to understand at various stages that the children must have to help with the IQs, etc. Lee Kuan Yew said, look, I'm sorry if I give extra focus to a certain aspect of society. Just out of every 1,000 children that are born, a certain percentage is near genius or above average. And a certain percentage is otherwise. Okay? He says, I have come to realize through study and research and everything, concrete evidence, that those people who have the above average and near geniuses are the ones who ultimately promote and lead our society. So we must have the best minds run our countries. Not in terms of just politics, but in terms of churches, traditional rulership, everything. Today in Ghana, a lot of us are stuck with churches. We believe anything, our pastors believe them. So the church has become an important tool now. That from the pulpit must come intelligent education. The churches must hire resource people to train their people. A certain percentage of what you get must go into training young people and, you know, building them up in entrepreneurship and all these things that we require in skills and everything. Some of the people are giving money they're not supposed to give in church because tithes, God has stated what you give. Offerings you can give, but you don't give your capital into church and go and sit down and look up to God. A lot of people are giving wrongly into churches and the pastors know they're enjoying this. We don't have time, and I've gone into a lot of detail in some of those thinking that I have. Education is absolutely important. You know, the type of education that we have. The education, apart from the home, which is important, the school one as well. School leadership is not because of, it should not be led by being a long service teacher. No, it's a specialist area. Otherwise, there'll be conflict with the teachers. School leadership is one. Secondly as well, the classroom content. Listen, it must be a mixed bag of course, some theoretical, intellectual discourse, interactive classroom, student to student. So confidence is built. Today, Charlie, you are going to lead the class. Because those are things that go into that. Talking about classroom education, credits must be given to students who come up with informed opinions, who come up with the solutions to problems, and then students who come up with very creative stuff. Credits must be given to encourage creativity and innovation. In education, there are certain activities in the classroom that promote the use of the various minds and the various senses. The human being is made of various minds and various senses. So the person is holistic, not partial. In Ghana, we're training only the intellect. It's for retention and some processing. Other countries, 86% retention. Look at us, chew, paw, pass, and forget. China has stopped reciting for exams. China was focusing on a lot of creativity, creative thinking, creative imagination. Imagination is for big things. Because as a nation, we must have a program or a vision that is far bigger than us, and we challenge ourselves to do it. That is why we need a certain type of leadership. Great leadership.